Hello everybody, welcome back to my YouTube channel. My name is Emma Goldemond, I am a conductor and I made my very first mini-series that is all about queer conductors. So, why do I make a little series about queer conductors? First of all, because it is Pride Month and I thought it was the perfect moment to go and mess around with this theme. But second of all, I wanna discuss the subject because I don't really know that much queer conductors who came out in public about the fact that they are queer and that are not ashamed or that fought for their identity being queer or having same-sex lovers and stuff. So I was a bit surprised that I did not really know that much queer conductors. And then, of course, I am a queer conductor, if you wouldn't guess it already. So that is the reason why I started this mini-series. In this mini-series I'm gonna discuss Benjamin Britten, who is technically seen more a composer than a conductor, but he did both, so I'm gonna discuss him. Then you've got Leonard Bernstein, also composer-conductor. You've got Maren Elsop, and you've got Yannick Nézin-Séguin, what I am gonna round up the mini-series with. I am sorry that I wasn't there last week. I was feeling a bit sick. Otherwise, I wanted to start on the 1st of June, of course, because that was the start of the Pride Month. And then it would be funny that I start my mini-series. But I couldn't because I was way too sick. So here I am. I'm better right now, don't worry. And let's start with Benjamin Britten. The years of Benjamin Britten.
I believe that the artist must be consciously a human being.
What you're now gonna see is an explanation about the beginning of the relationship between Benjamin Britten and Peter Pears. Benjamin Britten was, of course, the composer and conductor, and Peter Pears was a singer.
In 1939, he went to the United States. Like many people of Horton's generation, I think driven by a feeling that Europe was staggering towards another explosive blow-up and that Europe was finished as a civilization. He travelled with a friend, Peter Pears, an up-and-coming young tenor. While they were in the United States, they initially lived in a shared house with W.H. Auden in Brooklyn, which is probably every student house you've ever lived in times three. But they gradually drifted away from the Auden circle. Britten and Pears also formed a relationship. They were not a couple when they travelled to the US, became one when they were out there. And that lasted for the rest of their lives as a long-running marriage, as they said. It's basically a long, long gay marriage, long before that was actually legally possible.
As just mentioned, at that time it was legally seen not possible to have a same-sex relationship openly known by the public, because that would bring you in trouble, and that's why Britten and Pears kept their relationship hidden from the public. But in the archives that are still accessible, you can find an awful lot of evidence and paperwork that gives us a kind of glimpse of how it was to be gay in the years of Britten.
There's also quite a lot of social history about what it was like to be a gay couple at the time that Britten and Pears were together, because for the vast majority of their time as a same-sex marriage, their relationship was illegal, and they had to go through various compromises and charades almost to maintain this image of being a professional partnership that just happened to share a house. One of my favourite items in the whole collection, really, is a very humble little scrap of paper in the receipts collection. It's from O&C Butcher, a clothes shop which is still there on Aldborough High Street. And it dates from January 1966, so 18 months or so before the Sexual Offences Act that made Britten and Pears' relationship legal. And it details Britten's purchases throughout 1965, the final months of that year. And it's a very pedestrian list of purchases, like four pairs of socks, a couple of Viella shirts. Britten buys some bow ties, presumably for performance purposes. And then there's one line that says, shoe repairs, brackets, for Mr. Pears, 8 shillings and 6 pence. And that for Mr. Pears is basically a signal to the auditors, or to anyone else who may see this document, that the two men are keeping their expenses religiously separate. They don't have a joint bank account, of course, because that would really be breaking cover as a couple. So they have separate bank accounts, they keep their expenses separate, they know who pays for what, and they claim expenses back off each other. And that, for Mr. Pierce, is basically a message saying, nothing to see here, not a couple, I'm going to claim that 8 and 6 back off Peter, please move on. But of course it also tells us that at some stage Britain or his representative went into O&C Butchers and said, can I pick up Peter's shoes? And the person in the shop said, fine, yeah, we'll put them on your bill. Because people know, and broadly speaking, the town is supportive of them. As long as these various little compromises are made, the town is fine with having these two men living together as a couple unobtrusively at the edge of town.
The next fragment is a moment where Benjamin Britten talks about collaboration and how it inspires him to write music and to perform music. And although he doesn't name someone, it is pretty clear that he is talking about Peter Pierce. And afterwards, you've got Lucy Walker talking about how his collaborations between Pierce and Britten were going on and how bold they were in their time for collaborating and keeping their relationship hidden, but then giving it a kind of space within their music activities.
I don't honestly think I can write in a vacuum. I have to write for people or for occasions. I get inspiration, I get incentive for writing for people. That is my greatest pleasure and almost, as I say, the only way I can write.
Pierce was a singer, Britten was a well-known composer and often a performer himself. They often appeared together in performance with Britten at the piano or conducting and Pierce singing. Britten wrote a huge amount of music for Pierce to sing. Pierce was his muse above anyone else throughout their lives together. There are countless songs and major roles in nearly all of Britten's operas. And a number of Britten's works are surprisingly bold in their depiction of male-to-male romantic love. There's Billy Budd, which is an all-male opera featuring effectively a love triangle between three men. There's the Michelangelo sonnets written in 1940, settings of Michelangelo's very romantic poetry dedicated and written for a man. And there's Britten's Canticle 1, composed in 1947, with its refrain, I my best beloved am, so he is mine. And this was premiered in 1947 with Britten at the piano and Pierce singing. And it was written very much as a love song for Pierce to sing. But nobody at the time reviewing it or writing about it seems to have noticed this. It may be that they were too polite to say or perhaps didn't really appreciate that that was what was going on. But it is one of Britten's most romantic songs and is definitely written with Pierce in mind. Given how discreet Britten normally was, these pieces are surprisingly bold choices. But it seems that even though he was forced to keep his sexuality private, at times through his compositions, he did allow the truth to emerge.
There is a controversial side if it comes to Benjamin Britten's sexual orientation. I'm gonna tell you a little anecdote about the way I discovered Benjamin Britten's music. So I sang in a choir, as you guys know, as a child, and one day my conductor decided to sing the Ceremony of Carols from Benjamin Britten that year around Christmas. And that decision became a kind of tradition. So on a yearly basis, I started singing this famous piece. And one year I said to someone close to me that I would sing that piece and that he should come to the concert. And this person answered, oh, that famous piece from Britten where he in a way admits that he was a pedophile. I was like, he what? I was shocked, of course. And the first thing I did was finding ways to prove that he wasn't, of course. And then later on, I looked into it, and he was, in the most purest form, he was a pedophile. He loved children, and he often fell in love with young boys.
And if you go towards the very last opera he wrote, which was Death in Venice, which he wrote in Venice, and he cancelled a very important heart operation for it. The whole opera is about a man who goes on holidays in Venice and then he falls in love with a young boy. The story is not his. It is Thomas Mann, his story. But if you look at this opera, which I did, you see the whole fighting that was in his head if it comes to his feelings for young boys. And he even admits that during the preparation of this opera, he fell in love with the main character, which was a boy. And I read that in the book The Rest Is Noise, which I mentioned in my Conductor's Library video. But however, that is the controversial part of Benjamin Britten, which is not really often spoke about because he, of course, never had a sexual relationship with boys, but he fell in love numerous times with boys and fight against that feeling for years and years until the end of his life. Because although it was not the biggest deal at the time, because same-sex relationships were forbidden all over the place, so in the gay community at the time, falling in love with boys was not a deal. He was ashamed about it, and he did everything to fight the feeling. So that's a little thing I wanted to add that was not in one of the fragments I showed you and that nobody had called out until now. Okay, that was it. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you watched until the end. And if you have done, a massive thank you. If you want to follow up on the rest of the series, consider subscribing and looking to my previous videos. Thank you. And next week, it is Bernstein I'm going to talk about. So have a lovely week. And I hope to see you next week. Bye-bye.